Amen. Good morning. Good to see everybody this morning. Let's take, let me get that put back together. Let's bring this morning's worship to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this beautiful day and for this opportunity to come together here at New Mercies. We just pray that you'd be with each and every one of us as Pastor brings the word, and that word would reach our heart and that we'd carry it with us this week as we see others. Again, we thank you, Father, for all the blessings we've received. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand and help us make a joyful noise.
Christ on the road. Thank you. few announcements we'd like to make. I want to remind you, we started Sunday school. Red teaches it, and it starts at 9:15 every Sunday morning. Before, when they started out, they had quite a few people, and over time, the attendance has dropped down a little bit, so I know everybody gets busy, but it's a good time. Maybe next week we'll have somebody give a testimony about Sunday school and the importance of it, but we'll maybe do that next week. It's good, you know, just to get together. You learn the Bible, you get to know the people you go to church with, because you're able to share. Because, you know, in church I get to talk, but you don't get to talk too much, you know. But in Sunday school, everybody gets to give feedback. So I hope you'll consider that. Community Day will be coming up in August, the second Saturday in August, but Sunday, June 25th, in a couple weeks, we'll be having the first organizational meeting for Community Day. We had a preview of Community Day last night. The pavilion was full. We had visitors, people that were here looking to find somebody to grind stumps. We had people from about 10 people from the black churches in Cleveland. And it was a great time, just a preview of what Community Day is. It's always such an uplifting time, and we look forward to it every year. So I know you'll want to be part of that. Ladies Bible study will meet at our house tomorrow morning at 9:30. If you need directions, see me or Linda. Board meeting this coming Friday is the Friday noon lunch bunch, or 1 o'clock lunch bunch. And if you don't forget like I did last time, we'll hope to see you there. And this coming Saturday also, we're having our hymn sing. And we might, if the weather's real good, we might do that down in the pavilion. We have a little preview of that in our special music, as Dan will be leading us in a song. And Dan comes and helps Bob and Vicki out with that. So I hope that you'll take advantage of each of these things. I'll talk a little bit more about the last night in just a few minutes. I called Mike Root the other day about something. When I have a problem with my computer, he's one of two people that I can call, because he knows something about them, other than much more than I do, and seemed a little weak in his voice. But they were riding their motorcycle last Sunday afternoon, and the tire slipped out on a turn, and they went down, and she broke her wrist, and he has some cracked ribs and some other aches and pains and bruises. So I want to remember Mike and Nancy. Virginia was scheduled to have her surgery last week, but they couldn't get the machine sterilized or something like that, so they found another location to have it done, but they're not sure when that will be, so keep in mind. And Bob Coldflesh was able to be out last night for the fish fry, and I hope you all had a chance to say hi to Bob and welcome him to that, as his health isn't the best, but good to see that he was able to be out. So let's bow for prayer at this time. Father, we thank you so much for your love, for caring for us, for the so many ways that you bless us. We thank you for the fact that you're with us always. Please be with Mike and Nancy as they recover, and Virginia as she waits to find out more. Be with Bob and other elderly that aren't able to do all the things that they would like to do, and how frustrating that can be. But we're just so thankful that we have the assurance that when this troubled life is over, we have the opportunity to go to heaven, to be with you, and to be with all those that have shared our faith in you through this lifetime. I thank you for this church. Thank you for each one that's here today, and just pray that as we've worshiped and looked to your word, that you would draw us closer to you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Happy to have some guests in our service today. You know, we have a Wednesday night group that meets at Jim Skinner's place, work on tractors and do all the guy stuff. We have the fanciest can crusher that you would ever want to see. So if you want to come for no other reason, just come and see the man's can crusher. But Dan Yoder's with us and his family. Didn't know they had a family, you know, I just know the guys, you know, but most guys have families, so it's good to see the other part of their family as we come together. This time we're going to show some pictures from yesterday, and I just want to say a few things. We went to the Memorial Day service at Munson last year, and a general from the Air Force spoke, and he said all the right things. But he shared a story, and the story meant more to us probably than all the right things that he said. And so I just hope that we realize that it's the stories of our life that impact us and that impact others. He told the story that he was in the Air Force, they'd done a tour over in the Middle East, and they were all excited because they were coming home. And there was a Army transport plane that was going to bring them home. And they're all excited, talking about everything that they were going to do when they got back and how happy they were to be out of that part of the world. But when they got on the transport, there was a coffin with a flag. And somebody, a soldier, was killed, and they were bringing his body back. And he said the mood changed. Because all of a sudden, they realized that a sacrifice had been made. They were excited about doing their thing, but that young man was going home to a family that would not have a son or a husband. And so I think as we look at the Christian life, we realize that it's the stories that make a difference. So we're going to show some pictures, a couple scriptures that I'll share as we watch some of these. Psalm 131 says, "How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity." You know, as a church, we're a family. We had almost a record crowd for a fish fry last night. People came. I always thaw out more fish than I think we're going to need. And we had 42 people, I think, sign up last week. And it's getting time for the thing to start. And people keep coming over the hill. And, you know, families with 6 or 8 people, about 8 or 10 people came from the black churches in Cleveland. Somebody else, a friend of Bob Holweiler's, came that had called me about doing some stumps. And I said, "Hey, we're having a fish fry. Come on over." And so he came. And there were other people there. We need to share the love of God and let people know that there's a place where they can be loved. And we're not here to judge them. We're here to love them. We're here to care about them. And we want to do those things. 3 John 1 says, "I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth." There was another place where Jesus talked about His mother and children, her children had come, his brothers came, and Jesus said, "These are my children." So we have our physical children, but also in the church, we have a spiritual family. And I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. I guess the pictures are done already, but I'll talk a little bit more. So we're cooking fish, and we've got a good crew that does that. They've got Ken and Dan and Ray each know their job, and we get everything done. Didn't have a chance to eat. You know, we're cooking. Some of them took a little break and ate something, but I didn't get to eat yesterday. I had a few fish at the end, but there was custard pie that I love. There was strawberry shortcake. But and Matt and Tilly helped out. Ray and, not Ray, you're Ron. Ron and Sue's grandchildren. And Johanna was there. A lot of people helped. Originally, we thought we'd have to eat up in the dining room because it's so much work to carry everything down. And so I called Sue and I said, well, you know, I know it's so hard, so we'll just do up. Oh, no, no, we've got help. And so by the time everything was done and I got done cooking and then visiting with my friends from the black churches and other people that were there, Bob Cobeflesh was there, Dave Pastor's wife, Sherry, that's because of her physical condition isn't able to get out. But the good thing was, I always say, find somebody, you know, that you don't know and make sure nobody sits alone. Well, nobody sat alone because all the tables were full. And it was a blessing to see God's people. I tell you that I didn't eat, not so you feel sorry for me. Oh, he didn't get strawberry shortcake. He didn't get custard pie. And there was a lot of good food. But by the time, you know, Jesus tells us, or the Bible tells the story about Jesus and the woman at the well. You know, and he goes there about noon, and he's hungry, and the disciples go into town to get McDonald's and bring it out and everything. And so Jesus talks about the living water and shares the faith. And when the disciples get back, they offered him food, but he wasn't hungry. He says, I have food to eat that you know nothing about. Then his disciples said to each other, could someone have brought him food? My food, Jesus says, is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Don't you have the saying, it's 4 months until the harvest? I tell you, open your eyes and look on the fields, for they are ripe unto harvest. I was full, but it was sharing the love that I have for the people that were there. You know, the Bible says some plant, some water, and God gives the increase. So everyone that was there last night that greeted our guests and shared the love that we have for people, everyone that was there was planting and watering so that God can bring the increase. I'm really excited about Community Day because we had a little taste yesterday of what God can do when we humble ourselves, come before him, put everything aside, and just do the work that God calls us to do, caring more about helping other people than we care about ourselves. And we all find that. Our work is to do the will of him who sent me. And when we do, there's no greater joy. If you have had any part in somebody coming to faith or someone growing in their faith, coming to know Jesus as Lord and Savior in a deeper way, there's no greater joy that you're going to have than being able to do that. And we can all do it, whether it's just a smile, a kind word, we're glad you're here, or going a little farther and sitting down and trying to get to know people and talking about them and rather than ourselves. You know, sometimes we have the habit of, if you have a good story, you know, you want to tell it. But listen to their story and don't always tell your story. So I'm excited about what's going to happen. And I've taken time to talk about this because I think it's more important maybe than other things that I will say, although I hope the other things I have to say today are good as well. So you ready for the kids? We got the trombone and the singing, or you can go with the kids. Kids maybe want to go, so we'll let the kids go at this time, and Dan will come and lead us at this time.
God is bigger than you can possibly imagine. If you try to, in your mind, picture what God is like or what heaven is like, it's impossible. The Bible says, eye has not seen nor ear heard, neither has entered into the hearts of men the things that God has prepared for his people. And that's true in this world, but ultimately, as we are able to enter into heaven, that will truly be fulfilled in that way. And one of my favorite scriptures is, the heavens declare the glory of God, the firmament shows his handiwork. Day after day they show forth speech, night after night they display knowledge. The heavens, you look at the heavens, and we can only see so much, but now with the new telescope that they have, we can see farther than we've ever been able to see before. And God's creation is more expansive, more powerful, more beautiful than we could ever imagine. You know, we hear the words, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. What was that like? How was it possible that God would create the physical world that we're a part of, the heavens, this earth, and all the goodness that we enjoy every day, especially in beautiful Geauga County, the privilege that we have to live in this beautiful place. God is more than we can possibly imagine. How can we know this God? How can we relate to this God? Well, we can, because Jesus came into this world to show us who God is and how we can relate to him. We're in a series called The Fundamental List, the list of fundamental things that we need to believe so that we can be right in our relationship to God, that we can know him, and we can know how to respond to him. And last week we talked about the fact that every year more and more things are added to the church. We look at the Old Testament, we look at the New Testament, we see the Pharisees, and they had added rule after rule after rule to the laws that God had given them, so much so that God had been lost in all the traditions and the rituals and everything else. But if we're not careful, we can allow that same thing to happen to us, because more and more things are added that aren't essential, that become traditions, and then those traditions sometimes can obscure the simple basic truth that there's a God that loves us so much that he sent his son into this world so that we can know him and that we can relate to him. And we keep adding more and more things to that. But what are the essentials? Because sometimes the non-essentials, if they become essentials, obscure the true essentials. You know, we're so tied up, you can't do this, you can't do that, that the love of God is maybe lost in that understanding. The teachings of the church are all important, the Old Testament, the New Testament. But the Old Testament is the foundation for the coming of Christ into the world. We're thankful that God worked through hundreds of years to prepare the people for the time that the Messiah would come. And then Jesus came into the world. And Jesus, who Jesus is the way that we can understand and know who God is. And in Philippians 2 it says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. So Jesus came into this world. And how did he come into this world? He came as a child.
He came humbly. He came teaching. He came serving. He didn't come into this world. If you were God, how would you come into this world? Would you want to come and say, I'm here to straighten you guys out. I'm here to tell you what you need to do, and I'm going to see that you do it. And what would people say? How would they respond? I've said this before. Somebody tells me I have to do something, my first reaction is, you're going to make me? Do I have to? You know, that's our reaction. But Jesus came into this world and loved us, and we can respond to love. And love is serving and caring about others more than yourself. Philippians, speaking of Christ, said, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. He was God, he came into this world, but his godness was not something he was going to use to push us around. Rather, he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, and being found in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death. Who was he obedient to? Who was he following? He was following the will of the Heavenly Father. Obedient unto death, even death on a cross. If you know that scripture, it goes on to say that because of this, he's given a name that's above every name, that the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord. So Jesus came to demonstrate the love of God. He didn't come to defend himself. He came to save others. He didn't deserve to be treated the way he was treated, but he didn't use his godly powers to rebuke those, even though there are others that were. You know, when they went into Samaria and he was rejected, what did the disciples wanted to do? Let's call down a little fire. No, that's not why Jesus came. He came to demonstrate his love. We can respond to love, but we don't respond to power. And so Jesus came in love. What is the Bible trying to tell us about who God is? You know, if you tell me what you want, I can find a Bible verse to support anything you want to do. You know, you want to take control, push people around, I can give you a verse. You want whatever you want to do, you can twist the Bible to say what you want to say. But the question is what is the Bible trying to teach us about who God is and how we can relate to him? I think it's more important today than ever before, because we live in a world there where there's so much division, so much hatred, so much anger. You know, if you disagree with me, I hate you. You know, that attitude, that is so far from what Jesus came humbly to teach us. And sometimes those ideas can even creep into the church as religious groups become the props for political groups and other people that are trying to accomplish something. And because of that, Christianity in many ways is becoming irrelevant in our culture. People just don't want to hear about it because it doesn't fit their ideas. Last week we looked at the first essential, and that is where Jesus said, "Who do men say that I am?" And Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And that was where it all starts. That's the foundation of our faith, that Jesus came into this world as the Son of God, God's King, that had been looked for up until that time. Today we want to look at a passage of Scripture. The disciples are meeting in the upper room. It's the Passover, and Jesus is winding up his ministry, and he's trying to teach them everything that they should have learned, but they don't know completely yet. First part of it's a very familiar passage of Scripture in John the 14th chapter. Almost every funeral I preach, I use this Scripture. "Let not your heart be troubled." So are you troubled in this world? Are you concerned about what's going on in the world today? I am, but Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me." And then he talks about the mansions where we get to go. And then in verse 5, it says, Jesus said in 4, says, "You know the way to the place I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Been with Jesus for 3 years. Watched him, how he reacted in every situation, saw the miracles that he performed, how he was criticized and how he responded to those criticisms, everything else they had seen. Then Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well." From now on, you do know him and have seen him. I want to ask a question. When you think of Jesus, what do you picture in your mind? When you think of God, what do you picture in your mind? And the question is, why do you picture them? Is it the same when you picture God the Father? Is it when you picture Jesus? Maybe when we picture Jesus, we figure the Savior that came. He humbled himself. He came, you know, to help us. But sometimes maybe when we think of God, what do you think of? You think of God up in heaven. Maybe the Old Testament, you know, where when they got out of line, there was fire from heaven. The earth did open up and swallow people. But Jesus here is telling us, if you know me, you know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him as you have seen me. So Jesus is saying, I'm here not to tell you about who Jesus is. My will, my purpose is to do the will of him that sent me. The words that I say, they're not my words. I don't do what I want to do. I mean, if he did what he wanted to do, maybe he would have reacted differently. But he came to do the will of the Father. Philip then said, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus is getting a little bit frustrated here. You know, show us the Father. And, you know, 3 years they watched him, and he is here to represent the Father. Jesus answered, don't you know me, Philip? Even after I have been with you such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? They didn't get it. Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I say, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least, believe the evidence of the works themselves. The evidence of the works. Miracles, teaching that made sense. All of the things that Jesus did that made sense, he said, believe them. If we picture God as this vengeful person up in heaven just waiting, you know, get out of line and crack, you know, cross the knuckles, you know, did something wrong, then we aren't understanding that God is our loving Heavenly Father that just wants us. Story of the prodigal son. The son went away, wasted everything, wasted the opportunities that he was given, everything that he had, he squandered, and then he comes crawling back home, you know, kind of with his tail beneath his, what is that expression? Sneaking back home, just wanting to be a servant in the Father's household. But the Father says, no, have a party. Tony Campolo wrote a book, The Kingdom of God is a Party. It's to be what we did last night, to get together, to be in a loving relationship with people where we enjoy ourselves together and we're thankful to our loving Heavenly Father that makes it all possible. He gets all the honor and the glory, but we get the benefit of everything that we have because of who he is. That's what God wants us to know and to be. And so Jesus is meeting and saying, this is who I am. And I hope, I don't know if I've ever used this illustration or not, but if I have, I'm thinking maybe it wasn't right. Have you ever heard the judgment seat? You know, you stand before God, and then Jesus swoops in and says, oh, he's with me. I'm his defense attorney, and I'm going to defend him against God's judgment against me. I don't know that's one of the things kind of that gets added, but I don't think that that's the way it's going to be. We have a loving Heavenly Father. God loves us just like Jesus loves us. God loves us so much that he allowed and sent his son to save us. And so we don't have to be afraid of God. We just need to appreciate God. And when we appreciate him, we will honor him for who he is. So I hope that if maybe we need to rethink our view of God and know of his love for us, because that's what it is. The next scripture that we have on our sheet is one that we've used before. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The word logos here talks about the essence of God. In the beginning, God was. The essence of who he is beyond our understanding, beyond any physical thing that we could imagine. God was there. He was God. And then the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory as of the only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. So we see the glory of God, the goodness of God in Jesus. And it's Jesus that represents the Father to us. And we are able to be in his presence and to know him. So in the Old Testament, they were able to understand certain things. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, who he appointed heir of all things and through whom he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. So Jesus, in the past, God inspired a prophet to tell us something about God, something that God wanted us to know, maybe some rules to guide us, like we make rules for our children so they don't get hurt. You know, don't touch that stove, it's hot, you'll get burned. Don't play in traffic, you know, you get run over. Parents don't make rules arbitrarily, they make rules to protect their children. And that's the same way it is. In the past, God spoke about who he was through the prophets and what they should do. But now he has sent Jesus. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. So important, the foundation for Christ's coming. It says the law is, in the next verse, the law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming. You can tell something by shadows. I was cutting trees one time, and I cut the tree and it started to fall. And I started to run away. I couldn't go that way because there was a big ravine. So I ran that way. And I saw my shadow. And I saw the shadow of the tree. And it was coming right for me. So I moved out of the way. Didn't tell me everything, but it told me something I needed to know and allowed me to get out of the way. It did hit my, knocked the saw out of my arm, ripped all the muscles off my arm, but that's one of my stories. But a shadow helps you, but it's not all that we need. Jesus came so that we could know fully who God is and how we should respond. In Matthew 5, this is a Sermon on the Mount, the beginning, it says, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets." The law and the prophets, the Old Testament, everything God did through the Jewish people is important, significant, and we need to understand it and know how God has worked. But Jesus came not to just give us laws, but to fulfill them. And when Jesus came, it didn't replace anything. It just fulfilled us so that we can know the full extent of God's love. Luke 19 says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." Do you want to know what our responsibility is today? We are to be like Christ. We are to continue the work that he started. And Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. And that's why when we get together in the pavilion last night or any time when we're around people, it's to share the message of God. We can't save anybody, but it's through the preaching of the word that people respond to the gospel and men are able to be saved. So we have a responsibility and a privilege of being a part of what God is doing in the world today. Isn't it exciting to think that God is using me? You know, think of Moses, you know. Somebody was saying yesterday, some people like to fish, you know. Moses is leading the children of Israel through the Red Sea. That would have been a great experience. But there was one guy that had a fishing pole, and he was casting into the water over there. So a privilege to be Moses. But God is using each of us in a way that we can be used to seek and to save the lost. It was hard for him to do what he did because he had to put himself aside. Going back to Philippians, it says the things that he didn't consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. So the privileges of being a part of what God is doing in the world today is not for our own benefit, not so we can say, well, look what I did. Jesus didn't do that. He just carried the will of the Father. And it was hard at times. When Jesus is going through the trials and going to the cross, it says, in the same way the chief priests and teachers of the law mocked him, he saved others, they said, but he can't save themselves. That wasn't true. He could have saved himself, but he chose to give himself so that we could be saved. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross, and we will believe him. I don't know if they would or not. You know, it's always when God did something in the Old Testament, they believed for a little while. It's kind of like 9/11, you know, when the towers came crashing down, the churches were full for a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, a month later, people are pretty much back to where they were. But Jesus going to the cross changes who we are. We are not drawn to power, to what God is going to make us do. We are drawn to the Father because of what Christ has done for us and how we can come into his presence. He could have saved himself, but he chose not to save himself, not to enhance his own reputation, but to lay it down for us. Paul writes earlier in Philippians, I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by my life or by my death. Doesn't matter whether it's how I live or how my life is taken from me. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. What a privilege to be a part of what God is doing in the world. Because as I said before, there's no greater joy, no greater satisfaction than to know that my meat is to do the will of him who sent me. My satisfaction will come not from accolades I could earn or rights that I can enforce on others, but simply to be used by God to accomplish his purpose in this world as we come together and Christ is glorified in us. Then we find joy and meaning and purpose in our life. Father, we thank you for the many ways that you show us your great love for us, how Jesus demonstrated who you were, and how we can know that you're our loving Heavenly Father. Help us as we appreciate all that we have and the joy of being a part of the family of God and how much we find our hope in knowing and being used of you to accomplish your purpose. How good and how pleasant when Christians dwell together in unity and are able to be a witness to the love of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please stand.
You are my supply, my bread of life.
That's nice.